Good morning to everybody. Welcome to this debate and thanks for participating. Good morning from Brussels, where at last we have found a piece of summer. So the sky is blue and bright this morning. But as the schedule is quite tight, let me immediately introduce you the panel of eminent MEPs that will participate in this debate. So I will be very short. We will have Mrs. Alessandra Moretti, who is MEP since 2019. She is, if I'm well informed, from the Veneto region in Italy. We will have Mrs. Galvez Munoz from Andalusia in Spain. She's MEP also since 2019. Sarah Mathieu is MEP for Belgium, the city of Ghent. MEP since last year. She's from the Green Group. Mrs. Galvez Munoz is from SCD, I think, and Mrs. Moretti too. And then we have Mrs. Picerno. She's from Campania in Italy, and she's the longest in the European Parliament since 2014. And just checked what they all studied. So we have a philosopher, an economist, a lawyer, and an expert in communication today. So it should be an amazing panel. Let me thank you then all for the participation. They have all received in the meantime your questions of the partners and of the participants in this debate. And as the schedule is quite tight, we have asked them to work these questions into the answers they will give to our question. Very briefly, just what is the Recovery and Resilience Funds is the main instrument of the European Union to tackle the economic crisis after the COVID crisis. 13% of these funds, in total about 700 billion euros, have already been allocated to the member states during the summer. The whole amount will be allocated somewhere in the beginning of 2023, and these are large amounts, 190 billion for Italy, if I'm well informed, 70 billion for Spain, and about 6 billion for Belgium. Now, the question that is interesting us, of course, is, and that I ask to answer to every of the MEPs, is, are you sure these funds will reduce social inequalities inside your member state? And if not, what could be done to change this? And I don't know, is Mrs. Moretti among us or not yet? But yes. Shall we start with Mrs. Yes, Galvez Munoz?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good morning to everybody.
And that is...
Can I start?
I hear you. And that is...
I have to wait.
No, go along.
Okay.
It's about 10 minutes, and when I near 10 minutes, I will do some gestures to say it's time to close.
Okay,
go along. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you to everybody. It's a pleasure for me to be here with you. And when we talk about recovery and resilience facility, the discussion always appears to be focused on the green and digital transition. It's a fact that this instrument obliges member states to allocate at least 37% of spending to the fight against climate change and 20% to the digital sector. At the same time, however, we cannot forget that according to the framework drawn by the European Commission, each national plan must include measures for equal opportunities, inclusive education, fair working conditions, adequate social protection, and gender equality. Essential elements that should not be worth less than the green and digital transition. For this reason, in order for the Recovery and Resilience Facility to truly represent a tool capable of reducing social inequalities, together with our colleagues from the SND group in the European Parliament, we have proposed that the governments of the member states reserve a percentage equal to 30 7% of expenditure to gender equality and social inclusion measures. The RRF is a valuable opportunity to reduce social inequalities and ensure future generations at future that, in addition to being green and digital, leaves no one behind. I would like now to talk about the situation of my country, Italy. The latest AOCD economic study on Italy, published a few days ago, shows that the participation rate in the workforce remains particularly low for women, especially those with children. The study highlights the need to improve access to child care services and adult training in all regions. Now, is the moment to invest in women empowerment, and we need women to do it. Italian Prime Minister chose a high-profile female figure for the coordination of the Technical Secretariat of the Recovery and Resilience Plan, Chiara Goretti, one of the most important positions in the control room at the Palazzo Chigi. This is a clear sign. Women must be the protagonist of the decision-making process if we want a fair and just Europe. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Moretti. And in which way the principle of gender mainstreaming has been applied in the context of the recovery fund? That's one. Do you have any indication on this? Is this okay with the way the recovery fund has been created and allocated? That was one of the questions.
Yes, you know that with Ursula von der Leyen, like president of European Committee, for the first time we have a woman that decided at the initial of the mandate to create the gender mainstreaming. So all the policies that the European Parliament decide for the future need to be based on gender mainstreaming. And this is a claim, this is a principle fundamental and very important for us. So in all the committees we are working on, and we are obliged to indicate the gender equal process and gender equal measures to decide all the decisions that we will take. So also the governor and the countries need to base on this principle, fundamental principle, their decisions. And so it's a very important issue that the committee, the European Commission, said at the beginning of the mandate. So we are very, very inspiring to control that all the countries based on this principle, their policies. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Don't know if Mrs. Calves-Munoz, is she there? Valentina, no?
Not yet, so we can continue with
yes, continue. Well, I gave the floor already to Mrs. Picerno.
Okay.
Go on.
Okay, you can hear me? Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. First of all, thank you for organizing this event that will help us to compare the various national plans and will allow us all to fully understand on how our indication, those for which we fought in the European Parliament, have actually been received by government and the national parliaments, especially on the issue of a gender gap. I want to begin by saying that I will focus on a particular theme which concerns my country, a particular case in Europe, along with the social inequality, the gender gap, the generational gap. In Italy, there is another important gap, the territorial one. In no other country in Europe, except Germany in the 90s, there is such a deep gap between different geographical areas of the same country. This is not the time, of course, to analyze the secular causes of this gap, which have their roots from Italy unification, but it suffices to say that the south of Italy has about 1/3 of the total population, 34% to be precise, but it is produced GDP barely a fifth of the country, about 20%, and consequently records a serious delay in the material and the social infrastructures, making it one of the most underdeveloped microregions in Europe. It is in this framework that social and gender inequalities are to be analyzed. Did the Italian recovery plan take this into account in its drafting process? The answer is yes, but as the Commission also noted, the issue will later to be ensured that the distance between the intentions and the actual implementation of the plan is as minor as possible, in particular on social and gender policies. Today, I will focus on one topic in particular, the rate of unemployment due to care needs. It's 35.7 against European average of 31.8. The difference in the employment rate between women aged 25-49 with preschool children and women without children is instead 74.3. Rate of employed women is 53.8 compared to European average of 67.4. These differences between our country are mainly, but not exclusively, due to the situation in the southern Italy, where there are profound differences in the public services for children and health and healthcare, and where it is even more difficult to affirm the principle that work of care and family care is in fact a job, and not to be misunderstood as a simple domestic duty. What can be found in the plan to tackle these issues? First of all, the nursery plan. The places offered in nurseries are generally very, very low, but dramatically low in the south. A budget of 4.6 billion has been established, which will be used in particular for the provision of school infrastructures in the south. Other resources, around 1 billion euros, were also allocated to the full-time school extensions plan and school canteens, and another 300 million euros for sport at school. All expect that when not tackled by the public welfare become a burden of a woman most of the time. Another measure that is particularly close to my heart because it will also have a significant impact on the condition of women in the South is the one aimed at the local health care. Also in this case, assistance to fragile people, the elderly with disabilities, is relegated to women. In the south, this is even more true for the lack of the service. A total resource of 7 billion has been allocated for these issues. We continue with 4 billion allocated for the improvement of the home care and telemedicine, 1 billion of the resources for the creation of 381 community hospitals for the treatment of mild and less severe disease, and in additional 2 billion for the creation of over 1,200 territorial assistance points, in particular for the people over 65. I focus my speech on this issue that most closely concerns the combination of social inequalities, gender inequalities, on a particular aspect encouraging the participation of women in these in the labor market and the reconciliation between family and professional life. Because I believe this is the deepest issue of inequality. My intervention is a partial one, of course. There will be so much more to discuss, both on social and gender inequalities. What I have described are all national measures, not dedicated exclusively to the South, but in reality they are, because they tend to balance the level of performance and the assistance, and also because in the South they will have a double impact. As a member of the European Parliament monitoring the implementation of the plan, we need to guarantee that what is right on the plan is concretely implemented in the reality. Thank you very much for your attention.
Okay, Mrs. Pichero, thank you very much for this interesting view on the imbalances in your part of Italy and what can be done about it. With my apologies to Sharon, I think Mrs. Gorges Munoz is she leave early, so I have to give the floor first to her. Mrs. Gorges Munoz?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Yes, I am. Yes. Sorry. Hello.
As you know, our question is quite simple about resilience and recovery funds. And do you think this funds will reduce social inequalities in your country? And if not, what can be done about it? So I'll give you the floor now for 10 minutes about if you are ready for it. It's okay.
So about the national recovery, Spanish recovery plan, in on the one hand, is following the rest of the plans, looking forward the recovering of the economy, but at the same time transforming our production models, especially into a greener, more digitalized economies. But also what is important, especially important, our Spanish plan is very much highlighted, is that it is trying to address also the existing inequalities and to combat them, not also income inequality or individual inequalities, but also territorial inequalities, like in Spain, as Alessandra was saying, the case of Italy are quite remarkable and important. And but also gender inequality, it is a key element of the Spanish plan. And what the Spanish government and the different institutions, because it's something that is also sort of kind of co-share with the regional municipalities as well, is together with other instruments of the multi-annual financial framework, promote investments and reforms in priority areas at the EU level, such as the ecological transition and the digital transformation, as already said, in order to be sustainable and inclusive. and to reinforce, this is something I have worked quite a lot on, research and innovation and strengthening the social and territorial cohesion. As I said before, there are several transversal objectives as move toward a greener, digital, a cohesive from a social and territorial point of view, and the gender equality is a key aspect of the plan, because as you know, women, we are not very much present on either or environmental or digital sectors. And we really need to change that in order we could also, we could, in the sense of women, we could also enter those sectors, but at the same time be able to design the future and the world that is coming. In this plan, also the long-term care system is very important, and it is included. And obviously here, the what we have learned from the COVID is very much included. So this and also another thing I would like to highlight is that also from the S&D group, we are working with the European Parliament to include social conditionalities on the economic governance, especially within the European semester, to integrate social scoreboard on the European semester, and which, as you know, is the framework for the coordination and maturity of the economic policy. It just as a tool as well to monitor social progress and make sure that the actions included in the plans contribute to the social objectives and to improve the economic governance as a whole, so that the unequal social consequences of the economic policies are considered and especially diminished.
Okay. Mrs. Galvez, that's it?
Well, if okay, I mean, if you have any more questions, and I will be happy to answer, of course.
You're quite optimistic that on this imbalances, the recovery fund will have an impact in Spain and in Andalusia?
Well, I'm optimistic because we have been working hard for that, but I'm very worried as well, not only in Spain, in general. I think both the twin transition have a lot of opportunities for territories to transform, for economies to transform, for many people to take profit from these opportunities, but at the same time, we have to acknowledge that there is a risk too, that that will increase the already existing inequalities, and this is something that worries me a lot. And I think, as a member of the European Parliament, my focus will be exactly on that, working on how to avoid that this transformation will imply inequality increase, as I say, regarding different inequalities criteria, as income or gender or territory. Coming from Andalusia, as you say, it's obvious that not all regions will benefit, are not hit in the same wave, the climate change and so on and so forth. So we really need to make sure and to work very hard at the Parliament. That is really my aim and the one of my political family and the political party, just to avoid these transitions will end up with increasing inequalities.
Okay, Mrs. Galvez, thank you very much for the effort and for stopping in between. The message will come through loud and clear, but I will release you from the line, and thank you very much and have a nice day.
You too. I'm very sorry for the noise and everything. Yes, and I appreciated your effort. Thank you. Thank you a lot. Thanks.
Okay. And sorry then for Sarah Mathieu for having to wait that long, but the reward is you have the last word, the final word, for the last 10 minutes. Again, the question, social inequalities in Belgium, will the recovery fund help to it? The floor is yours, Sarah.
All right. Thanks a lot. I think first I'd like to make a general comment on the social dimension of the national RRF plan. So as you all know, earlier this year, the member states did sign the Porto Declaration, where they have committed to develop and deepen the social dimension of the single market. And of course, as Greens, we've always been advocating this. We think the European integration must go beyond the development of the single market or a common currency. And to us, Europe is also a project of social progress, upward social conversion. It's something that we're known for, social protection of people. But then again, today, one out of five Europeans does live in poverty or is at the risk of poverty and social exclusion. So that means, for instance, 92,000 Europeans actually lack affordable housing. They have an insecure job, can't make a decent living, and so on. So that means that we need European legislation, of course, in many fields. And I think we have to push the member states for structural social investment. And that is exactly, of course, what the facility mechanism can do for our citizens. So it needs to be compliant, the national plans, with the Porto Declaration and, of course, with the action plan of the social pillar. I think that that's not only important for one particular member state, it's something important for Europe as a whole. It will foster social coherence within the European project itself, and it will, of course, reduce inequities between the different member states. Because we know that some countries have really severely suffered from the austerity policy that the Commission has established in the past, because it has led to cuts in public expenditure, cuts, for instance, in welfare benefits, affordable public healthcare, and so on. And you also see, for instance, a health gap between member states. For instance, if you have a certain type of cancer, your chances to survive can be double or triple in Belgium vis-a-vis some Eastern European countries because of the quality and the accessibility of the public health system. I think there's also a political agreement, because putting the protection of people in the heart of European policies that will gain the trust of European citizens and the Union, and that might turn them away from popular and Eurosceptic parties. So I think that if we want to make the facility a success, we can, and it can be a turning point towards a more equal and fair Europe that we, of course, as Greens are striving for. Now, for my own country, for Belgium, the Belgian plan was approved by the Commission in June. It's worth about 6 billion euros, and it has, as expected, of course, a strong emphasis on the green transition and on digitalization. I think there's some good examples on climate policy, for instance, offshore winds, integrated water management systems, investment in sustainable mobility, public transport, etc. But there's also 26% actually ring-fenced for social policy. And the goals are, of course, to reinforce an inclusive labor market and invest in education for the recovery of the labor market. Now, in Belgium, we already have a percentage of 78 of high employment rates. But there are, of course, geographical gaps there. There's a gender gap there. There's a gap between the high and the low educated workers. The labor market is not very inclusive, and we really need to increase the employment, for instance, of people with immigrant backgrounds. And so the government really wants to prevent the temporary unemployment that has been a good solution throughout the pandemic, of course, to safeguard people's income, that would become permanent. And we know that It were mainly the vulnerable groups really ending up in these temporary unemployment schemes. So the government of Belgium will provide education, training, targeting groups, such as, for instance, lowly educated women, youngsters, people with disabilities, immigrants, to support them entering into the labor market. And of course, this is very important. We've always advocated to have a more inclusive labor market. And a good measure, for instance, that will be taken is to increase the capacity for childcare, mainly for young children, to encourage their parents to enter labor markets. So I'm really in favor of these measures. I think that they're a good mix between labor market measures and social investments. And on top of that, the government will also reinforce the performance of our educational system. So particularly, it will focus on the trainings in the field of STEM, so that's science, technology, and engineering and mathematics, because there's really a shortage of these profiles at the moment in the workforce. And while on top of this, there will also be investment in the healthcare system, which shouldn't be a surprise. Belgium was, as many countries, hit hard by COVID, and so it will reinforce healthcare systems, it will increase hospital capacity, it will invest in research and development in particular fields, for instance, also regarding hospital nuclear medicine and radiation therapy. So maybe a final comment. I think that the RRF really represents the first ever political achievement towards a greater European integration. So I think it's an important step. Crucial reforms and investments undertaken by the EU and member states will be funded by a common debt instrument, something a couple of years ago no one would have imagined. So we know that for now it's only a temporary mechanism with a lot of potential, I would say. But I think we're at a turning point towards a more sustainable and socially fair Europe. And well, this single shot might be a start for something permanent. I think given the major challenges ahead, I think it would be a really good idea to thoroughly consider the extension of the facility after the period where you know, it's supposed to be in form.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Mathieu, for this interesting discourse, on, especially on a few other aspects than the other ones addressed, the health and the Green Deal issues in the recovery fund. So it's quite interesting. And I'll look a little bit now to Mrs. Zokani, if we still have time for a question, or should I already round up?
If you want... I can start, or if you have some question, we can.
Just one question that comes to mind. To the two MEPs that are still present, Mrs. Picerno or Mrs. Mathieu, how will you try to follow up from the European Parliament on what is happening with the recovery funds? Do you see any opportunities, given also the fact that budgetarily there's not much leverage from the Parliament on this instrument, as I've understood, but I don't know who wants to answer. Mrs. Mathieu?
Yeah, I mean, of course, these are national plans. And well, I've followed them since, as Greens were also in the Belgian government. So of course, there are strong ties there. But I think, well, I'm here to represent the European citizens. So of course, it's a different perspective, but we do have the scrutiny working group in the EP that will assess the national plans. And for instance, last week, the head of the Recovery and Resilience Task Force did come to the AMPL committee, which I'm a member, to debrief really on specifically the social dimension of the national plans. And I would say, well, it wasn't entirely reassuring what we heard. So some national plans, they seem to be only partially satisfactory in the view of the Commission, and there's still a dialogue, of course. And I think it's my task as an MEP to keep the pressure high and to make sure that the goals that are being set, that they are actually met. Because, well, it's interesting to see that that is really the idea with the RRF. It's not just a blank check. Really, the goals need to be met, and this will be monitored. So I think that that's a way for us as a parliament to keep involved in the entire process, really.
So I give the floor to you. I thank for all the MEPs for participating, and for the audience, I just can draw attention to the fact that on the website of Wise for All Challenges and the Sustainable Communication, well, you received all the information. There are videos with each of these MEPs where they explain also their point of view on this question with a few other ones. So if you want to see and hear more information of this, you can go along there. Thank you very much anyway, and I give the floor to Mrs. Zokali for the last word.
Thank you very much. And while thanking the member of the European Parliament once again for their participation, I'd like us now to turn to how this debate fits into the Wise for Challenges project. Wise for Challenges begin as an evolution and in line with the Wise for All campaign, which was first launched in 2015 by ESCOM, Sustainable Communication, aiming to promote women's participation in innovation in view of contributing to the building of a fair and inclusive society. The objectives of Wise for Challenges are: promote and reinforce the participation of women and girls in Europe, engage civil society organizations in the EU Parliament initiatives, integrate the female voice in a multidisciplinary fashion in Europe policy as Green Deal, education, health, and social policies, make arrangement for the Wise for All network to participate in the Conference on Future of Europe and at the Recovery Fund debate with a gender approach, promote the Wise for All Charter of Value and the European values it represents, raise awareness about the role and democratic values of the European Parliament as the voice of the European citizens, and boost a deeper engagement with them. Support together.eu communities by reinforcing the participation of the civil society. The active participation is the key word of our project to guarantee continuity and vision to the topics covered. That is why our affiliated entities represent networks at local and EU level. At the beginning of the project activities, we created four working groups on Green Deal, education and culture, health and social rights. The working groups is led by Women Entrepreneurship Platform, INCOMA, University of Pisa, and Libera, Associazioni Nomi e Numeri Contro le Mafie. One of the project activities is related to the Recovery and Resilience Facility debate. As you know, the European Commission and the European Parliament and the EU leaders have agreed on this instrument that will lead the way out of the crisis and lay the foundation for a modern and more sustainable Europe. A gender-sensitive approach with gender mainstreaming and gender budgeting principle reflected in all aspects of the COVID-19 response is necessary to avoid an increase in social inequalities. In this project, we carried out analysis on the use of these resources in Belgium, Spain, and Italy. In preparation of the debate, we created one online survey to measure citizen knowledge about this instrument, and four, surveys to understand citizen needs for the future EU action on health, Green Deal, education and social rights. You can find the surveys on our website, as they will remain open until the end of November. We will then draw up recommendations that take into account the information collected. To date, we have collected a total of 393 responses, not only in Italy, Spain and Belgium, as our partner will explain in the second panel. To complete our analysis, we interviewed some members of the European Parliament who have been at the forefront of protecting the gender needs in Europe. You can watch the interviews in full on our YouTube channel, but for the moment we have prepared this trailer as presentation of the work done. To me, we will now take a 15-minute break, at the end of which the second panel will begin to present the first result of the surveys. Thanks to the participation of our partner, thank you to Mr. Gerolf for your cooperation. So stay tuned at the same link, because after this short break we will have a lot of more to tell you.
Okay, thank you very much and have a nice day.
Thank you.